You are listening to the Final Say Radio Show, a Rappaport Media production, with your host Brett Rappaport and co-host John Rappaport.
Well, John, we have our guest, Mark Krikorian, who's the executive director of the Center for Immigration Studies, and he's held that position since 1995. And of course, he's been on found in many news outlets, from the Washington Post, the New York Times, Los Angeles Times, and many of the networks. And of course, we've read through his. He was before the Senate Committee on the Judiciary, I believe it was April 22nd, giving some great testimony, and we'd like to discuss some of that. But Mark, I've got a great idea for amnesty. I think those of us who have been paying taxes too often and too much, we should get amnesty this year.
Yeah, sounds good to me. The illegal immigrants and their employers who didn't pay taxes in the past all get amnesty for those non-payment of taxes. It sounds good to me. I mean, where do I sign up for my refund, you know?
Well, we say that jokingly, of course. But, Mark, first of all, it's a pleasure to have you on the Final Say Radio Show. We appreciate you taking time this afternoon. And I certainly appreciate the information that you provided in your testimony. And I've learned quite a bit from that and some of the other things from the center. But if you can, if we look at the Senate bill S-744, and as they're talking about the process of, a pathway to the somewhat close to 11 million people to become citizens, you bring up a very good point, numerous points. The first is, well, what about security, securing the border, preventing future amnesties, but what about the fraud that has been involved in all of the prior amnesties?
Well, yeah, I mean, the fraud, it was enormous. I mean, the big amnesty we had before this was passed in 1986. And the fraud is legendary. It was so extensive. Our estimates are maybe one quarter of all the people who got amnesty did so fraudulently. And the big area of fraud, the most fraud-ridden part, was a part of the amnesty which was for farm workers. Well, what happened was the qualifying for that was very easy, very loose rules, no follow-up, no nothing, political pressure on the bureaucrats to rubber stamp stuff quick. So they ended up giving amnesty to people who, said they had picked watermelons off of trees. You know, they actually sat some of these people down. They said, you did farm work. What farm work did you do? I picked watermelons. Oh, yeah, did you pick the watermelons from the watermelon trees? Oh, yeah, we climbed up ladders and picked them off the trees. Women came in with long, sculpted fingernails saying they'd been working in the fields. I mean, it was ridiculous. And it's not just ridiculous because it also has real consequences. For instance, Mahmoud the Red Abu Halima, who was an illegal alien Egyptian cab driver in New York, got amnesty fraudulently as a farm worker. And that amnesty, that legal status, enabled him to then travel to Afghanistan, get his terrorist training, and come back and help lead the first World Trade Center attack.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that. And then you also mentioned the other guy, Mohammed Salame, who he was turned down for the status, but they didn't remove him from the country, and so he assisted in that bombing.
Right, exactly. And that's the same with the current amnesty in the sense that if you get turned down, the legislation specifically says nothing in this bill requires the Secretary of Homeland Security to deport people who don't meet these criteria. In other words, you got nothing to lose by applying except the application fee, because if you get turned down, nobody's going to do anything about it. So really, ideally, what ought to happen in anything like this, whether it's an asylum hearing or an amnesty processing or anything, is that the person gets a letter saying your case has been decided, please come in and we'll give you the results. And if it's a yes, here's your card, welcome to America. And if it's no, well, here, follow Bruno here to the airport and we're going to send you home. But that's not what we're doing. That's not what this new legislation would do.
Now, Mark,
sorry.
I was going to say, this is why I think the border security first is so critical, because look at the issue we have with terrorists or gang thugs, right? Our criminal system is just inundated with illegal aliens. And the problem is our border is so porous that it almost pays for America to pay the high cost burden to keep them in prison, because if not, they'll be back over in 2 weeks perpetrating more crimes against our citizens. So if we had honest security at the border, then we could deport these people, put them back in Mexico's cost, let them go in Mexican prisons, which, as you know, would be a far less enjoyable experience, and we would have a lot less worries about terrorists coming in. So it's hard for me to imagine that not having security first should ever be the basis of any conversation. Once that's out of the way, then we can have the normal debates about labor and big business and language and things of that nature.
Yeah, I mean, I agree completely. I've even told pro-amnesty people, I said, look, the way you're going to get your, even if I don't like it, you might actually make progress if, you know, we actually had some real enforcement in place and working first. And it's not just on the Mexican border, remember. Close to half the illegal population comes in legally with some kind of visa and then just never leaves. And we don't have any good way of knowing who leaves, so we don't know who is still here. Those kind of things you need in place. And also, the other thing we need is E-Verify. This is an online system so that when you hire somebody and you do their paperwork, there's all the paperwork you do now, it's just that you actually check their Social Security number and their name and their date of birth and see if they're real and if they match. And so it makes it hard to lie to your employer about who you are. Those kind of things need to be working, functioning, the ACLU lawsuits against them over, before you then talk about what to do next. And this bill by Schumer and Rubio has, you know, puts the cart before the horse.
Mark, you pointed out in the current Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, which is referred to as DACA, that somewhere in the neighborhood of 99.5% of applicants are approved.
Yep.
Now, to me, I mean, 99.5% of anything seems off.
Yeah, it's obvious. I mean, it's obviously absurd. This is the amnesty for illegal immigrants who came here as children, and the president just did it on his own, unconstitutionally, because Congress had already voted it down a couple times, and he just said, "Well, to heck with you, I'm just going to do it anyway." But even then, if they had actually, you know, applied the standards strictly and checked everybody's application, what have you, it would be harder to oppose, but they're not. It's all done through the mail. There's no interviews except in, you know, special cases. So we have no idea if, you know, this is all fraudulent stuff. And remember, even the last amnesty, one I'd mentioned, the 1986 amnesty, even in that one, 10% of people who applied were turned down. With all the fraud of people who got through, 10% were turned down. In this amnesty that the president has done on his own, only 0.5%, one half of 1%, have been rejected. That's kind of ridiculous.
In the first amnesty, I was going to say it was only around 3 million people, not 11.
Right, exactly. Yeah, 3 million people applied. 2.7 million people actually got their amnesty. Now we're talking not just 11 million, remember, but the amnesty that is before the Congress, the Schumer-Rubio bill, actually permits people who have already been deported to come back and apply for amnesty. This is amnesty for foreigners abroad. So, you know, it could well be more than 11 million.
And when you look at how the trend lines were affected in the society after the 3 million, you can only imagine after the 11. Mark, I have a very specific concern here, and I'm curious your opinion around the world, maybe where somebody else has done this well. To me, take a business approach to this. Anything that should occur, long before we get to read a bill, there should be a very clearly stated set of goals and some metrics, right? What does success look like, and how do we measure success, and then what happens if we don't achieve success, right?
And sure.
So clearly we're not doing that, which should make us nervous from the get-up. But are there any countries that you looked at? Because we need to be somewhere – we can't be like Japan where you let almost nobody in, right? So you're so homogeneous. But how do we – Where do we look to see somebody who really has done an impressive job on their immigration process, being both fair to the potential immigrants, but also being respectful to and providing for what the country actually needs in their immigrant population?
Well, I mean, I wouldn't even rule out Japan. The point not being that you have Japan's level of immigration, that's a different issue. They don't allow really any notable level of immigration. The question is, how do you run your immigration system? In other words, it's almost more a plumbing question. In other words, does the machine function properly rather than what the machine does? You know what I mean? And frankly, Japan and a lot of countries have much better immigration, even European countries that have they have an immigration problem with the Muslim immigrants from their former colonies that have moved there. But those are people, for the most part, who move there legally. Even in Europe, their system of tracking people who come in and foreigners who go out and that sort of thing is way better than ours. And quite honestly, Mexico has a tighter immigration system, at least on paper, than we do. In fact, Mexico's immigration system is something much more punitive than ours and much more restrictive, more like Japan's in the sense of who's allowed in and what rights they have. It's very primitive, I would say, and, you know, backward in the sense of what the rules are, but they actually enforce their rules. That's the problem for us, is the political incentive to actually enforce the rules is very weak here, because left-wing groups, ethnic chauvinist groups, and big business all work together to prevent the enforcement of immigration laws.
Which, by its very nature, should make us all run in fear.
Sure, yeah. I mean, absolutely. It's all big institutions, big government, big business, big labor, big media, big philanthropy. They're all on the same side. Whereas the way the founding fathers, you know, when Madison wrote in the Federalist Papers about interests counterbalancing each other and different factions sort of fighting it out in Congress and, you know, kind of keeping a balance, it doesn't work that way, because everybody, all the bags of money on this issue are on one side. And so it shows.
It really does. I want to go back to your plumbing comment. One of the things that concerns me, just as, you know, average John citizen, is the fact that we have a police presence that's virtually neutered, meaning so many states, the feds basically don't want to allow states to protect their own borders, and then you have so many police departments who are basically purposely violating the law and not following through. And this is a huge problem, because if we're not protecting the borders, and then we're not allowing the police to actually keep us safe at home, why even have a border?
Well, good question. I mean, frankly, a lot of the advocacy groups on the other side of this issue don't want a border. I mean, business groups reject the legitimacy of borders. Libertarian groups, the leftist groups, they're all basically in bed with each other on this issue. And they think that national borders are, at the very least, an anachronism. And in many cases, they consider national borders, national sovereignty itself, to be immoral. It's just that they're smart enough not to actually say that. It would be a lot better debate if the people who oppose at least America's borders, the existence of those borders, actually came out and said that honestly, instead of, you know, dance around the issue with focus grouped comments.
I think there's a very simple solution to this whole issue, and that is you set up a program where you allow people to be checked for the possibility of legal status, but you make it known that anyone who is given status, you have two choices. You're either going to be removed from the country or you're going to stay here, and for a 20-year period you're not allowed to collect on social programs, and you're going to have to be current on your taxes or you will be deported. And I can guarantee you that that 11 million number would be about a couple hundred thousand.
Yeah, the problem is that any of these attempts at walling off people from the social service, social safety net, never work.
Keep them hiding.
They just can't. It just doesn't work. In a modern society, we're not going to let people die on the steps of the emergency room. We're not going to tell little kids, no, you're not allowed in this kindergarten. It's just not going to happen. If you want to limit the costs of unskilled immigration into a modern society, you have to keep those people out in the first place. Once they're here, the game is over. Stop whining about it. Just you have to either keep them out or accept the costs. There's really no third way.
No, it's a good point, but, you know, I've seen several studies that have, you know, shown us that the overall cost of this could be in the trillions. And to me, and you guys had an article today, you're talking about the slush funds that are going to be involved in this bill, which I'd love for you to comment on.
Sure. There's two separate slush funds actually set up in the bill. They're not called slush funds, obviously, but that's what they are, for the Homeland Security Secretary to dole out money to the various community organizing leftist groups around the country to help illegal aliens apply for the amnesty and, you know, do various things like that. So it's, it's a way of funding La Raza and other groups like that with taxpayer money. It's really pretty amazing.
You know, it's funny. You know, we're citizens. Well, you know, at least you, I, and John are, and Beatrice. But I don't know about the people listening. But, you know, every day there's some form of paperwork that we have to file to be compliant and following the law. And when we don't, there's a price for us to pay. And I think a problem for many people in this country is the fact that, you know, you go 30 miles per hour in a 25, you get a $125 ticket, and you have a court appearance, your insurance goes up. But here you have a case of people, and I forgot how many laws you said they violated, but you listed a couple of them. People who are here illegally have violated numerous laws, and there's really no consequences for their actions.
No, this, you know, I mean, the Schumer-Rubio bill basically gives them a pass on identity theft, fraud, tax fraud, Social Security fraud, perjury even. Because if you've worked on the books as an illegal alien, and most illegals who work on the books, they've committed perjury when they signed the I-9 form that said who they are and that they're authorized to work. All of those things are just, they just get a pass. The bill does require them to pay a fine of $500 down and $500 paid in installments in order to get the amnesty. That's it. And employers don't even have to pay that token fine. They just get a pass for, you know, non-payment of wages, non-payment of taxes, knowing employment of illegal aliens, all of that stuff. They just get a pass for free. They don't even have to pretend to pay a fine.
I was just going to ask you that because, you know, we look at our Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security funds, and maybe they would be more funded if we had more of these employers paying into a system as that, you know, they're taking advantage of something.
Sure. I mean, that's, you know, that's part of the appeal of hiring an illegal alien.
Yeah. It, this whole thing's amazing to me. I'm not very confident that we're going to like the result regardless of how this turns out. My hope is that it doesn't pass now, at least.
Well, I'm pretty confident you won't like the result. I mean, it's not going to get, you know, much better, or if any better. I mean, the bill is a bad idea in its construction. It's not like a couple of amendments are going to kind of clean it up and make it better.
Is it too big? Sorry, John.
They're always too big.
So anyway, yeah, I mean, it's a mess. And, you know, my hope is that it's going to fall apart from its own, you know, collapse under its own weight, which is not impossible.
Right, but this requires a lot of people. Our listeners and thousands of listeners from shows all over the place need to get on the phone and really scream and yell and let their people know that, you know, you represent America, and even, I mean, yes, we're an immigrant nation, but first we're a nation of laws. And to that point, Mark, I would love to see a program that actually started with a drain the swamp mentality. So instead of doing the thing that, you know, that looks really bad on film, like it's all about depriving services of these poor people who on film look really sad and needy, you go after the businesses and you make it clear that if you're hiring people out, you're going to get enormous fines and you're going to pick up all the cost burden of these people being here. And secondarily, sponsorship. You know, if somebody's here on if you want to bring family members in, fine. Society doesn't pick up the bill. You pick up the bill. That's exactly how my immigrants did it in the turn of the last century.
Sure. The problem, I mean, I agree with the sponsorship thing, and Congress actually made the sponsorship provision that's always been in the law but was ignored for a long time. Congress made that a legally enforceable commitment now. The problem is, who is it that's going to tell you that an immigrant is using welfare? Social workers at local welfare offices. Do you think those people really are all that eager to tell anybody, you know, to rat on an immigrant, if you will, who's getting welfare? No, they're collaborators. I mean, they're co-conspirators, if you will, in the immigrants getting welfare, and they want to protect them so that no one – I mean, last year, one person was investigated – one immigrant was investigated for being on the dole, and because you can be deported if you're an immigrant and you're not supporting yourself. One person was investigated, and even that person they didn't deport. They dropped it. So, I mean, I agree. Obviously, people should be making commitments to support any relatives or others they bring in. The problem is, who's going to enforce it? It's not enforced, even the provisions that are in the law now. So you really have got to change the immigration rules so that you just don't take people who are likely to end up on welfare. You just don't let them in the first place.
Well, you know, the really sad thing here, and this could be put into a wonderful political ad, is showing all these fabulous people, engineers and scientists and folks who could really have a profound positive impact on this country, talking about we tried to come to the country legally and we were not, right? Sort of this whole thing, it's a fairness campaign. The president loves to talk about fairness, and this is, of course, both sides of the aisles do this, but we use the word fairness. How fair is it to all those people who have a lot to contribute to this country that we'd love to have here who can't get in or their cost is prohibitive because they're not willing to break the law and sneak over the border?
Sure. I mean, that's a clear, problem. There's no question about it. But the response from the pro-amnesty people is, well, let's just let everybody in. I mean, this bill would actually double legal immigration in the future because they're basically, it's more unskilled workers, more skilled everything. They're just saying every interest group that wants more people, they get it. It's almost like a pork barrel politics, only with visas. So, they have an answer for that. And so the response, what you need to think about is, well, even in this area, you have to think about how many immigrants do we really want? What should our immigration policy be? Obviously, illegal immigration has to be the first issue, because if you're not enforcing your laws, it doesn't matter what the rules are. But once you do that, you do need to take the next step, and it's, okay, well, who are we going to take? And that's a step that we often don't get to because we're still fighting over whether we're even going to enforce the rules we have.
Well, you said it very simply. This country can't deal with any issues unless we're going to be a country that follows its own laws. And I think we have people at the highest levels of government who are failing to do that, and therefore there is no solution at this point.
Yeah, and that's why I actually say I'm not sure that we need Congress to pass any immigration legislation. I mean, there are changes I think we need to make, but, what we need first is a commitment from the executive branch to actually enforce the rules. And this administration has done the exact opposite. They have made it a matter of policy not to enforce whole swaths of immigration law. In fact, it's so bad that some immigration agents have had to sue the government in Dallas in federal court, basically claiming that their superiors are forcing them to violate their oath of office. They took an oath to enforce the law. Their superiors are forcing them to not enforce the law, and that they've sued. And actually, they've had some good progress. The final judgment may come down this month, and they might win.
Well, that would be a good thing. Well,
yep.
Mark Krikorian, thank you so much for joining us today on the Final Say Radio Show. Please provide your website for the listeners so they can follow you and all the things that your organization is doing.
We're online at cis.org. It's Center for Immigration Studies, cis.org. And we're actually putting up we're sending out a new thing every day on this bill, at least for the next week or two, on all of the various provisions, the slush funds, the all kinds of stuff in there. It's really kind of amazing.
Yeah, well, I get your emails it could be sometimes it's almost every day, but at least a couple times a week, and I enjoy them very much. So, again, thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
All right, take care.